I'm Holly. I'm WWE superstar Seth Rollins' mother. Talking about Seth Rollins as a child, oh my gosh. An animated individual, I used to call him the drama king. He was always the one to push the envelope. So we used to have a pool in our backyard. He would leave his shorts out there by the pool. He would dry off with the towel and then walk into the house, subsequently naked. We live at the bottom of a hill. People can see you.
We had a big fence. It made sense to me anyway.
I kind of learned from that whole issue with him that everything is very logical. When he got his first speeding ticket, what in the world were you doing? Were you not thinking about this? And he said, of course I was. He said, but there's nobody around, so what did it matter? He was totally fearless of anything. Just due to the fact that he wasn't afraid of anything, we had to set limits for him because he didn't have limits. Nothing ever was physically impossible to him. I think that's probably one of the biggest things that we found out about him when he was younger. He didn't have those limitations.
I mean, I was definitely afraid, but I still did it. I had a brother who was 3 years older than me. He was more inclined to do crazier things than I would, but I had to do it with him because I had to keep up. We'd ride bikes and build ramps and, you know, try to find the steepest hills to go down. And I never felt fearless, but maybe I suppose from a parenting perspective, it might have seemed that we were risk takers, if you will.
We had a lot of the same interests. A lot of the things that I liked, if he didn't like them, eventually I could push him to like them. So what really made us bond, I think, after a while, was wrestling.
I loved WWE since as long as I can remember. One of my favorite things was the wrestling buddies. I had a Hulk Hogan one, and my brother had an Ultimate Warrior one.
Ultimate Warrior!
I remember the specific moment when he told our parents that he wanted to be a wrestler. He was going to do this basketball training camp. And he said, I want to go to this camp, but I don't want to play basketball after that. And they're like, why? And he's like, well, I want to be a wrestler.
Devastated. I was devastated that that's what he wanted to do with his life. All I knew was that there was Mad Dog Vachon. There was the Crusher.
I think my folks kind of just thought it was something I was going to grow out of at a certain point. So, but you know, when you're 13, 14, you're very stubborn. Very hard-nosed, and I set my mind to it, and that's what I was going to do.
He was dealing with a lot of teenage angst.
You know, you're just trying to figure yourself out when you're 14, 15, 16. So, moms don't understand kids. They don't get it. You know, they never will. If I ever have kids, I'm not going to understand mine when they're teenagers.
As parents, we decided that we were going to give him the door, and we were gonna open it for him. So we just took it step by step.
You know, I got out of high school and I tried to move to Pennsylvania to train, and they were supportive and gave me some cash for that, and we're really cool about it, and that didn't work out. And then when I came back from Philly, you know, they still gave me a place to live.
He was focused all the time. At one point, he was actually working part-time, going to college part-time, and he was training 3 times a week, which meant he drove back and forth from Chicago.
You know, it was a lot going on, but they were there to provide, you know, put a roof over my head and cook me dinner and be there when I needed them and stuff like that. And for, you know, a lot of independent professional wrestlers, that's not something they have. They're kind of off on their own doing their own thing. So I always felt like that was an advantage I have, just being able to financially be assisted by my folks, but also just have the actual support of them. Them seeing the progress that I started to make kept them more inclined to be supportive during that period of time. When I got offered the contract to go down to Florida and work for WWE in Tampa, that was the first time I really ever lived away from home. I was 24 years old. That was a massive adjustment for me, just, you know, trying to figure out how to be an adult, you know, how to buy your own groceries and, like, do your own laundry, because I never did that stuff before.
There were a lot of times where I would text with him and say, how's everything going? Is it everything that you thought it would be? And every time his answer has always been, yes. He never had a plan B. This was it.
It will be a night forever etched in history. A night heroes are created, careers are defined, and legends will be born. Welcome to WrestleMania.
Yeah, WrestleMania 31.
I told them to come to WrestleMania in San Francisco basically on a whim. You know, they don't really get to see a lot of my live shows anymore, but, you know, WrestleMania is like, it's the biggest show of the year, so it's just a special time. In retrospect, it was great that they were there.
We were sitting in the stands, and I remember saying to my husband, have you heard from him in a while?
I didn't have the conversation about cashing in. I certainly wasn't going to tell anybody about it.
And it was just like within a split second. I'm like, it's going to happen, it's going to happen.
Can't imagine, really, from a perspective of a family member or a friend, kind of what that was like. That's got to be pretty surreal, as it was for me.
Having him be able to live his dream, this is it. I mean, from the time he was 5 years old.
Something that I wanted so bad my whole life. I never wanted anything else.
And my first response to him when I saw him was just to hug him. That in itself was enough.
Wrestling school, Black and Brave Wrestling School that I run. When I'm on the road, it's very difficult for me to get back and be there and be fully involved.
And my mom, she does an awesome job as far as, you know, helping me out with my wrestling school. 6 months ago or so, maybe a little less, I kind of decided I wanted to have a place for the kids to live. So I bought a place and put some bunk beds in it. It's basically a frat house.
Clean, baby.
Cleaned up, Ed.
It's always clean.
Uh-huh.
Always clean.
It's not what mom says.
I want your mom
for me. It's like 13 or 14 dudes just living in there for a few months at a time and then, you know, transitioning out while a new crew comes in. And that's not something I want to deal with.
Hey! Hello! This is what I do.
You just come in and yell?
I come in and, hey!
She basically manages the entire property. When we bought it, it wasn't the nicest place in the world. And she went in and made sure it was all fixed up and got all the beds and got everything sorted and, you know, make sure we had proper, the water heater, washer and dryer, or anything you could think of that a mom would think of that I wouldn't think of, you know.
Do we have two refrigerators?
Two refrigerators, yeah.
When did I buy a second refrigerator?
I don't know,
she mom. Was there just too many dudes that have one refrigerator? Is that what was going on?
I didn't even know he had two fridges.
His concept in all of this was to be able to provide these people with a place for them to live and to breathe and to join the wrestling community and have it there for them with as much ease as possible. I can help them establish themselves as far as having a place to live, having a roof over their head, getting jobs, making sure that they're taken care of.
That's just kind of the person she is. She's always been. She's just always been a caretaker.
I want them to be able to live their lives and understand that this is how it is when you're on the road. You got to commune with people, you got to figure out how to get along with people, and there's some people that you're not going to like, there's some people that you're not going to get along with, but that's life. And if you can do that and do it on a continual basis for 12 weeks, then you're probably in a good mindset. probably just a continuation of this life with Seth Rollins and in this same vein with this school and with this house.
I want to reiterate a point that I made. You get out of it what you put into it.
He has probably made me extremely proud of the type of person that he is and how he treats other people.
I started the school kind of as a way to give back, I guess, to the independent wrestling community in the Midwest. I just really wanted to be able to have a place where someone who was me when I was that age could come here and break in and cut their teeth in the business. I lived here my whole life, and it's one of those areas where everyone always talks about wanting to move away. Like, I never thought that way. Like, I always loved it here.
He has not become jaded. And I think a lot of that also has to do with the fact that he constantly comes back here. This is the home base. This is where the people are who are honest with him and say, hey, you know, I'm the first one. He'll tell you that. I'm the first one to tell him you messed up. And he doesn't always listen to me. You know what? I don't always listen to him either.
For me, it's really nice to come back home, have friends and family, but also just have a place that's not so chaotic. It makes it a lot easier for me to live a simpler life, I guess, instead of living in that chaos of like a New York City or Los Angeles or something like that. I couldn't do it. The traffic alone would drive me insane.
Even people that he's come back to in our community, our little town in Buffalo, have said to me, you know, you did something right as a parent because he's a decent human being. And that, for me, is more important than anything.
That means that Quebec wrestler and world star. Pretty good, not too shabby.
Mon nom est Suzanne Benoit et mon fils Kevin Owen est une superstar de la WWE.
My name is Terry Steen and my son is a WWE superstar.
Oh yeah, I am.
Yeah, baby.
I really love this town, so that's why I've never lost that, like, that's where I'm from. No matter where I live, I'm from Maryville.
It's your base,
Yeah.
It's your place.
There's just a special feeling for me when I drive through this town.
Your home?
It's home. Yeah, I don't know there's really no other way to describe it. It's home.
You know, I mean, I had a real good childhood, real happy childhood. I can't really imagine it being any better. From the time I was like 10, 11, 12 years old, and anytime I wanted to just pick up and go walk out and go play with my friends, I could.
He went through all the basics like every other kid around here. He played hockey, played soccer.
And then I tried baseball one season, which had to stop because the games were Mondays, which meant I wouldn't get home in time to watch Raw. The game would end at like 8:30. So by the time I would make it back, I would miss the beginning of Raw, which was unacceptable. Finish the game, ask my parents what time is it? They're like, oh, it's like 8:40. I'm like, what? I just took off running.
Coming up next, we have a new surprise right here on Raw.
I got to my house, Raw had already started. I missed the Legion of Doom match. I was very upset. I made the decision, that's it, baseball's not for me. Besides the fact I kind of sucked at it, that's also collateral, like another reason why I probably didn't stick to it. It makes sense if you think about it now, you know? I was always so, I mean, I don't want to say hyperactive, but I probably was.
Il montait partout. Il grimpait ses meubles. On était pas capable de le laisser s'asseoir pas. Même à l'école, à un moment donné, le professeur a appelé parce que t'as pas quand même s'asseoir, parce que ça va pas que c'est faire avec.
I guess, you know, looking back now, I was like that before I discovered wrestling, and once I saw wrestling, and Like, I still try to figure it out. I don't know what it is that grabbed me the way it did. For some reason, one day my dad decided to rent the wrestling tape.
And now, WrestleMania 11.
That's the video store. As you can see, it's still standing. This is where my dad rented the tape that shaped who I would become.
Unbelievable power! Possessed by the British Bulldog!
I saw the British Bulldog and I was like, man, this guy's awesome.
British Bulldog Victoria!
To me, I was 11 years old. It was the greatest thing. And then the next match was great, and the next match, and the next match, and like, I was just hooked. And then Shawn Michaels came out.
Michaels, high risk maneuver!
He was by far the best.
Fell in love with it.
Like the next day, I went to the communal pool of our town, and I remember specifically talking about wrestling to people, even people that weren't my friends, like kids that I didn't know. But I had to tell them about the British Bulldog and Shawn Michaels and this and that. And I was already just obsessed.
Puis c'est ça, c'est le même. C'est pas plus que ça. C'est une simple cassette de lutte qui a vu Shawn Michaels. Puis il a décidé c'était ça.
It just took over my life like right away. Literally, it just took over my life.
The cool part is last year when they released my DVD, they actually they got copies of it. And my dad bought it here.
Coming back here 22 years later and getting his DVD, for me it was mind-blowing. I was working that day. I was in Montreal. I called my boss. I gotta stop this. I gotta go to the store. They got copies.
It's hard to imagine how far passion can bring you.
You know, my parents also cultivated my interest. You know, because once my dad saw I was into it, I started watching it every week on TV when it would be on, but my dad started getting the pay-per-views, and you know, WWE came to Montreal and they brought me, and but I never like felt like I had a path or a passion for anything until you know, WrestleMania 11.
So he came to us with the idea of going to wrestling school, and I didn't have any problems with that. That's what, well, if you want to do that.
Non, ça allait très bien. C'est sûr que sa passion, c'était la lutte. Fait que d'abord qu'à l'école, qui nous arrivait des popées, non, c'était bien.
I can't overstate how important it is that my parents, like, pushed me towards it instead of trying to veer me away from it. When I was 14 or so, I went to a local wrestling show. And my mom actually took me there because she had heard through somebody at her work that one of the guys there had a wrestling school.
When he started wrestling really, really, I said, okay, there's something going on.
I guess every kid at some point in Canada dreams of being maybe a hockey player, or you know, everybody around me did for sure. But then when wrestling came about, like none of it was an effort. Like I didn't have to try to do anything. I wanted to do it. So with what my parents had already told me about, you know, you wanted to get a job that you'd love. Like, oh man, this must be it then.
He caught on really, really fast. I was very, very impressed the speed that it took.
Take notice! Superstar!
From 2005 on, things just got crazier every year. I was working, I was trying to wrestle, I was going on the independence. My wife got pregnant. Like, life just came at us so fast. If my wife were here, she'd happily tell you we were not prepared. It was like, oh, it's like, this is crazy. We had my family and her family backing us up, and without that support system, none of this would have been possible. Like, I would have had to quit wrestling at some point.
I wish it would have happened to me. To have a dream, a passion like that. If we would have quit and done something else and not go to the end to see where I can go with this, it wouldn't be good. That's his destiny. There was something going on. There was a buzz, there was a feeling that it's not the same as the other guys.
I think we give him confidence. Puis on sait qu'il est capable, qu'il doit connaître ses limites pour savoir où arrêter. Puis c'est sûr que de temps en temps, quand il met des chaises, là, puis que c'est tout le temps lui qui tombe dedans, c'est un petit peu stressant, mais donc c'est bien.
Like, I got to the top of the independent scene. At that point, Daniel Bryan had already been in WWE, and by that time, Sami Zayn had signed, and You know, when William Regal came to a show in California is when everything got the ball rolling for WWE. But the night I won the Universal title, I remember talking to Triple H before the show and saying, man, it's so crazy. Like, I still remember, like, yesterday hearing, like, hey, Regal's going to be at that PWG show, and me thinking, oh, my God, if I can just get him to look at me. You know, thankfully, my match was good enough that Regal took notice. I was like, well, why do you think he went? He was there to see you.
Him and Sammy, we saw them always together. Really proud for them. Because they really had a hard time being accepted for what they looked like and how they did things. But it was entertaining, it was great, it was. And I think people saw that.
Whenever you're ready, we're ready to go. Are we going?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Kevin, your family. You seem to be very family oriented.
Like, I remember when I got to the Performance Center, Dusty Rhodes sat me down. He didn't know me at all. Sat me down with a camera rolling, much like we're doing today, and just like, just talk to me. Who are you? First thing I started talking about was my family.
You asked what my my goal was, my end goal, kind of, and why I'm here. And I, as much as I had faith in myself, and I really knew that I belonged here, maybe it wouldn't happen. But the part that kind of always kept me hoping and wanting to happen is how much like my parents put into this.
And then by the end of it, it was like, well, whatever we're gonna do with you, we're gonna have to make sure that your family's a part of it because it's you who you are. So he like, almost right away, like made me understand like, oh, it's okay to be who I am.
Kevin Owens the cover! Kevin Owens is champion! What did we just witness?
In WWE, they see my son as somebody that can be the champion. So proud, so proud.
This is my parents' house, by the way. This is not my own shrine to myself.
I wish I could say that I draw my inner personalities from either of my parents, but I really don't think I do. They're very good people. And what I do in the ring is not about being a good person.
And when we hear Kevin a couple of times beep out a couple of French words and on the shows and things like that, we find it really cool.
S'il y a quelqu'un qui a un problème avec ce que je dis, rentre dans le ring pour voir qu'est-ce qui va se passer.
Oh, I forgot you morons only speak one language.
I get to have a fortunate life of living my dream, wrestling in front of all these people, thousands and millions of people, and I get to share it with my family. But I really couldn't have done it alone.
When he comes by, when he's here, when we see him, he's the same guy he was when he was 19 years old. Family's first, his kids, his wife, us. We're proud of the man, the guy.
Puis quand on va ailleurs, ben je trouve qu'on, c'est ça, on représente notre Québec. Puis Kevin le représente très bien. On est fiers. C'est.
When we're with him to a show, that's when we realize really where he's at. We're so proud. He's really special.
Incroyable.
Yeah, incredible.
So this set, look at this, by the way.
Yeah.
This is my set. I'm the figure. Why am I falling through the table?
Usually that's the way it goes.
Look at, yeah, that's true.
You set it up and then
look at this crap.
Hi, my name is Daria Bullard, and my son is WWE superstar Titus O'Neil.
Hey,
at the age of 10, I went to live with my mom. I had lived with my grandparents up until that time. And at that time is when her boyfriend molested me. And that's how Thaddeus came about. And because I would not have an abortion, she brought me to South Florida. And I still wouldn't have one, so then she put me out, and luckily I met friends to go live with. I was scared, of course. I didn't tell my grandparents. I was feeling more of ashamed and embarrassed, like it was my fault that it happened, until years later when I realized people telling me that it wasn't my fault, I was just a child, and because I didn't speak out, nothing was done about it.
I know it was a struggle for her. I didn't find out why that struggle was the way that it was until I was 17 years old. Her being a product of sexual assault, and that's how I was brought into this world. I had a very strained relationship with my mother. When I found out how I was conceived at 17 years old, all that hate that I had towards her instantly turned into love, because it was at that moment that I realized that my mother was a kid trying to raise kids.
I still get choked up sometimes about it. I know that it wasn't my fault, but it still sometimes bothers me if I focus too much that my childhood was taken. I try to focus on the good things, the positive things. It could have been worse. I could have been on drugs. I could have been an alcoholic. I could have been a lot of things, but he is a blessing not only to me and my family immediately, of so many around the world that see where he's come from, and that if we could do it, they can too. From preschool, he was always the tallest, the biggest feet, the biggest hands. And so I think he felt awkward. We butt heads a lot because I would tell him to do something, he wouldn't do it. And by me being such a young mom, I really didn't know how to discipline.
And there was no male role model in the home. And I think a lot of the reasons why I was getting into trouble was more wanting to fit in and not get bullied, because I used to get picked on a lot because I didn't have the best of clothes. Shoes weren't always the greatest. I used to wear broken glasses. My nickname was Eyes. And so I used to either fight or cause a disturbance in order to try to keep from being the not cool guy.
He kept getting in trouble in school. I had a friend that worked with the program with young mothers with kids. And she was like, you know, Thaddeus keep getting in trouble. Why don't you send him to the boys' ranch?
The Florida Sheriff's Boys Ranch is a youth facility just outside of Live Oak, Florida. Many youth, like myself, that were troubled, went there to get a second chance at life with the hopes that we can all turn around and to be productive citizens.
In the beginning, when he went to the boys' ranch, he hated me. He thought that I had given him away and kept his brothers. After about 3 years, he finally realized why he was there, and he stopped hating the world and everyone else and blaming everyone else, and he started to develop, and it made a change in his life as well as mine.
That moment of going there at 12 years old and like feeling like I was thrown away, with already having a strained relationship with my mom, I felt like she had given up on me. As I've gotten older, I realized just how much my mom had to sacrifice. My mom didn't graduate from high school until after I graduated from high school. So I try to do my best to give her those moments now, realizing and understanding that, like, my mom is still a kid, really.
He was always into sports, even as a young kid. He didn't start taking sports serious till he got in high school. And that's when it made a difference. It was a joy going to see him play high school football. after we had went through so much, it was finally a turnaround that I was going there for something positive. And I think he appreciated it because I was there to support him through it instead of us bickering when I got there. When he got the offer to go to Florida, it was so amazing. Out of everything we've been through to get into University of Florida, look where we come from. How did we deserve to get to this point?
Second down and nine. Zhao in the gun, looking to throw, wanting to bring upstairs. Now jumping around back there. He'll be hit and dropped back at the 32-yard line. And Thaddeus Bullard came in there and brought him down for the sack.
I went there and ended up winning the national championship my first year there in 1996. Sports was my outlet. Sports allowed me to compete. It allowed me to learn how to work with other people, be on a team, take guidance from coaches. Once I understood my role on the team, then I understood my role in the classroom.
He is sacked for the first time today.
I know that like any other child in college, his dream was to go NFL. He had an opportunity, but his body didn't allow him. So he went to arena football. I know that's not where he basically wanted to be, but he made the best of it. WWE was really a far stretch because he watched it as a kid, but never showed interest in being a WWE wrestler.
First of all, I had zero plans of being a WWE superstar. My best friend was my neighbor at the time, Dave Bautista. We talked about it several times, but I just was like, I'm not doing that. I was driving one day in South Tampa to get a pair of dress shoes. Across the street was FCW, and I picked up the phone. Dave had already told me kind of, you know, where they train at and work out at, and I said, you know, Dave, is this the place where you were trying to get me to go? And he said, yeah. I said, well, I'm gonna poke my head in the back door and see what it's about. And 2 weeks later, I was signed and inside of a WWE ring bumping around.
When he told me that he was going to try out for WWE, I laughed and thought that was just something else, that he was going through a phase. When he called me back and told me he made it, I was like, you're lying, you didn't make it. How you made it out of all these people, how you made it?
My mom's reaction was like everybody else's, like, why are you doing that? You got college degrees. She was always supportive. She just didn't understand it because it was really out of nowhere.
He watched it with the other kids' granddad. They enjoyed it. That was something they looked forward to because they laughed and talked and it was a bond. And so I would let them go over there every Monday night and watch it, and they wanted to stay up till it was over. And I was like, no, you got to go to school the next day. So it was a little tug of war between all of them.
And I remember calling my mom. Prior to that, I played football and I was done with football. I was getting ready to go coach. I was either gonna try to go back to Florida and coach or go somewhere else and coach. And so even when we were negotiating a contract with WWE, I was like, look, I don't really have a whole lot of time to make a decision. John Laurinaitis ended up calling me back 15 minutes later. And he said, usually it's like a 2 or 3 month process. I said, John, I don't have 2 or 3 months. I'm either gonna do this, I'm gonna go coach. And he said, well, let's see if we can line you up for a physical. They flew me up to Pittsburgh. I got my physical that following Tuesday. And then the Tuesday after that, I was in class at FCW.
It's amazing how something that you never thought that you would do, you watch and admire as a kid and then never have that desire and then to get in it and succeed in it. But just to see the reaction of not only the kids, the adults, I'm impressed that he has such an impact from where he come from, how, you know, God put him on this platform. Usually on Monday nights, I'm calling everybody, Dad is on, and it was like, Dad been on TV, how long are you still calling everybody? But to me, it's the highlight of my Monday night.
Really what drives me is the people that invested in me and my mom and my brothers. I want to see that duplicated. That's what draws me to places like this is that I see other people doing the work, investing in the work, and you want to be a part of that.
You know, I think about, it's just been about 12 months since we first met. Going to the school and talking to those kids about staying in school, I never asked them, and he never asked for recognition. He just went and did it. Mm-hmm. And then just the ongoing connection with our families, and then fundraising, you know, close to $1 million of impact mm-hmm. and support has come through Titus's leadership and just being available.
I always say it's a blessing that he's able to give back, not only financially, but of himself. And I think it makes a difference when you have experienced it. It makes a bigger difference because a lot of people, they give money, and of course we want money to continue everything going on. But when you've had the experience where you couldn't get a new pair of shoes until it was Christmas or school time, you know what that truly means. And we know that it's genuine because we've been on the other side of that.
Is that for me? Or is that for WWE superstar Titus O'Neil? I'll take both.
So being respectful and being a good person can get you a lot more than money can ever get you. Growing up the way I grew up, with my mom's single parent home, it was the same way that a lot of struggles that your families have. We didn't have a whole lot. I couldn't afford nice clothes. So what we're trying to do here is make sure that you guys not only see the beauty in yourselves, but also see the beauty in people giving to you and helping you. Right? Everybody needs help. Keep in mind, people are always watching you. My mom always tells me, that's my mom back there. All right? Love you guys. I'll see you all soon.
Each accomplishment in his life I treasure, even from the time he was vice president of student council. Whoever would have thought that a kid that you had to make go to school and do what he had to do could overcome so many things. And to see the grandkids now, I'm very proud of them, and I don't get to as many games as I would like to, but I'm so proud that he's teaching them the way I taught him as far as being grateful. They're always loving and giving, and they like giving back. And it's such a blessing to see it go down from generation.
With Father's Day last Sunday, everythingfordads.com has announced its Celebrity Dad of the Year. And the winner is WWE Superstar Titus O'Neil.
First of all, I have two of the most amazing sons that any father could have. When they get shoes, and the shoes may be too small, because people send me stuff all the time. They're like, oh, Dad, I got a kid that doesn't have much at school. I want to give him these. That, like, almost tears me up every single time, because I realize, like, my kids get it. Like, we're very blessed. Every day that I see him, talk to him, I'm just proud. I'm proud to be able to even have the opportunity to be called father.
I thank God all the time that he realizes that you're not just a WWE star, you're a human being and you need to make a difference, and you are making a difference in the world. I am a very proud mom. I know sometimes I don't tell him enough, but he is my pride and joy.
Just this year, in front of 78,000 people inside of the Superdome, seeing my mom and dad so happy and so proud, like, it's priceless.
Who wants to be my WrestleMania tag partner?
It's up there, pick me, pick me, pick me. And he wouldn't even look at me. Why would I even look? Nah, you gotta pick that little kid.
I'm Sarah Scherer.
I'm Rick Scherer.
And we're Braun Strowman's mom and dad.
WWE superstar Braun Strowman.
I was a rambunctious boy. I mean, I was always up to something.
There was a mud hole, he was in it.
He loved the mud. So, I mean, what boy doesn't?
Parents would, like, every morning in the summertime when I was home, by 9 o'clock, Dad was yelling, get your butt outside, because I was driving him nuts doing something inside, probably banging pots and pans together or something. And they'd hand me a roll of duct tape, and I'd disappear for 8 hours and be making nunchucks out in the yard and stuff.
Well, we had our battles, but we had lots of fun, too.
Yeah, I think it was a lot about food, usually, because I wanted to eat, and she said I'd had enough. I think that's what I fought about the most. I can remember one time not getting ice cream that I wanted, and I was mad, and I slammed the car door so hard that it busted the glass in the door.
And look at the size of them. We cut them, I mean.
So blessed. My family's so great, so supportive of everything that I did, including everything my sister did. Dad was my little league baseball coach.
Go ahead and just tell the story. I was never one to coddle umpires, ever. One of my players got hit in the kneecap with a pitch. And I checked his knee out, and I asked, you know, the kid was limping real bad, and the umpire came over, let's go, let's play. I said, wait a minute. So my kid just got hit right in the kneecap. Give us a break here, and we'll run out of time. I said, I don't care, because I'm ahead. Oh, we got nose to nose. Oh, my God. They called the cops.
And some guy in the stand starts running his mouth, and I'll never forget this. Dad turns and he's like, if you don't shut your mouth, I'll drag you through this fence right now. And then somebody goes, call the cops, call the cops. And then we went from being undefeated little league team to maybe going 500 the next year, because they wouldn't let Dad coach anymore because he was too passionate.
Yeah.
Wonder where I get my temper from.
You got it, honestly.
Glad you're not looking at me.
He was never one to sit back and whine too much about something to do. He would find something to do.
It's just country life, simple living. I mean, this is it. I bust tables and wash dishes here at Butcher Boys, so I got a long history in this restaurant. When I was the richest kid in town, when I get my $40 paycheck after 2 days of work. Mike, he is the owner of Butcher Boys and has been the cook here and everything for how long?
25 years.
25 years, so he's seen me go from here to the monster I am now.
Well, we fed him good when we was working here. That gave it a good start.
Yeah.
So Trick, he gave us a break, you know, he's like, hey, eat at the restaurant.
The community's awesome. It's a real tight-knit, family-friendly place. The hustle and bustle of traveling around the world and all the craziness, like, still slows down here. People still say hi to each other and open the doors for people and stuff. Everyone's not just go, 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 go. So it's nice to come home and feel that humanity again. I was here. There was days had to have changed 100+ tires in a day and stuff, slinging them wheels on and off the thing, and it definitely helped keep me in shape and stuff like that with the strong man slinging the tires around and picking the transmissions up and everything else in between.
When he's a little kid, I always said, you know, you're gonna grow up to be a big man, and so you might as well find a job for a big man.
I'm probably one of the only guys that has ever stood there and fired a guy that size. I fired him one time because I can't remember what he's doing. And the next day he comes in and he goes, Tom, I really like working on my job. And I said, that's fine, you can come back.
I know what it's like to earn a dollar. I would work here 50 hours a week, Monday through Saturday, and then Thursday, Friday, and Saturday I would work at a bar or a nightclub in Mooresville or Charlotte doing security work on the side. Work, work, work. That's all I've ever known and all I've ever done. So I knew if I wanted to achieve something, I was gonna have to put the work in. And like, I wanted to be able to support myself and live, because like I can't take it. I've never been able to take anything from my parents. Like they would try to give me stuff on my birthdays and they still try to give me gifts. And I'm like, stop spending money on me. I don't like it. Growing up as a kid, I just thought it was cool my dad played ball, this and that, but then to watch and realize that he's one, or if not, the greatest player to ever play the game.
Now we're back into trouble. Rick the Crusher Shear.
And no wonder why, like, when I played softball, I always felt like I had a shadow looming over me. It was because I literally was standing in the footsteps of Mr. Softball.
People always want to know how to be a home run hitter. First of all, it takes a lot of practice.
It was a lot of fun. I enjoyed softball immensely. The team I played in was a family affair. When we went to tournaments, all of the families went along. I'm sure Adam dug it too, and Hannah later on, because they love going to all the ballparks and the hotels that had the indoor swimming pools. Everything was fine.
Going to ball tournaments, a lot of times I had to keep a harness on them because I couldn't keep up to them.
We tie him to the bleachers, and everybody complained on the beach because he's pulling the bleachers all over the ball field.
Field of Dreams. You see, look at the building, see all these dents in these warehouses. This is all from home run balls that were hit out here. I put a few dents in it. Dad put a lot of them in these buildings.
You played on this field, you played somewhere.
And that one's out for sure. Oh my.
Give me a bat. I didn't care if it was across the plate, if it was close where I could reach with the bat. I hit it, if it was that way, I hit that way.
Grand slam home run for Rick Scher.
I played to win. If I had to run you over, I'm running your ass over. I'm scoring this run. That's just how it was. After the game, if I run you over or whatever, I'd pick you up and let's go have a beer. But during the game, there were no friends, not with me.
Well, they don't call him the Crusher.
That's
for nothing.
Right. He crushes.
That's why I'm really, really thankful that people are so into my career and what I've done that they've dug further into my family's past and found YouTube clips and bringing all this stuff out that now as an adult that I can watch and appreciate for how unbelievable it was, because when I was a six-year-old kid, I didn't know what was going on, you know?
Well, he lined up to that man, Scher, at third. He has made some sparkling plays defensively.
Have the USSSA World Series in Orlando. It's one of the only places where people don't freak out about Braun Strowman. When I walk around there, that's Crusher's son.
Here is the Crusher's final word on the subject of being a home run hitter.
It just takes a lot of practice, and I think if the guy uses the ability he's got and gets his timing and stuff down and puts everything he's got into it, yeah, anybody can be a home run hitter.
Yeah.
We encouraged him. When he got to the strongman thing, I thought it was pretty cool, actually. I don't know anybody else that can lift 1,000 pounds.
I spent more time in here than I did anywhere for years and years and years.
This is where I made this.
Got the size to do it, and it's just a matter of he wanted to get dedicated and put in the work that it took to do it, and he did.
I never took weightlifting serious until 2009 when I met the guys down in Charlotte who were doing strongman. I decided I wanted to give that a try because I always enjoyed watching and stuff on TV. Started lifting heavy.
Determination was what was just amazing to me, because you would not be defeated. You can't teach that. It's in you, and it probably came from your mom and dad, especially your dad. So competitive.
I wanted to be the best at it, so I did whatever it took, and I was the best. I won North America's Strongest Man in 2011, 2012, won the Arnold Amateur World Championship.
Very proud. I mean, when he'd come home and he'd rattle off how many times he benched this, and I'd sit there with a pencil and piece of paper and add it up and say, you lift seven tons. And I said, you're wasting all this energy lifting, you know, you're not doing something constructive in it.
I felt like there was something that I am supposed to be doing other than crunching numbers or changing tires. I knew that I had a greater purpose in life than that, and I truly believe that I was put on this earth to be a WWE superstar.
Adam went through I don't know how many jobs and whatever, and he found the strongman thing, and then thank God for Mark Henry talking him into trying WWE.
It happened so fast. I'd always looked up to Mark as a strength athlete and as a performer in the WWE. And we got to talk, got to be good friends, and he kept an eye on me. And in 2012, went down to like my tryout. They liked, I guess, what they saw.
The strongest athlete ever to step foot in this building.
I packed up everything that I owned and I put it in a Kia Soul and I just headed for Florida with $150 to my name in my pocket when I started this journey.
First thing I do is just laugh.
Yeah.
Say, God, honey, there's our little boy. Look at him.
It's more of an amazing thing. Yeah. I mean, you know, it's like how many people have kids that are on TV doing WWE stuff on top of it all, you know, it's it. And sometimes it makes me nervous the abuse he's doling out to other guys too, you know. It's like, don't hurt him, come on.
He actually surprised the hell out of me. We actually gets in front of the camera and talks like he does.
And I stomped, and I smashed, and I snatched this contract.
He found his niche.
I couldn't have been raised by two better human beings. They were so supportive that no matter what I wanted to do, that they were never like, oh, come on, you just tried this and it didn't work out. Why are you gonna do this? They were always like, go for it. This year, ringside in front of 78,000 people inside of the Superdome, seeing my mom and dad sitting there and the look on their face.
Wow, awesome. It was just incredible. I mean,
it's worth more than any dollar I've made in this industry, anything that I've done. Like, seeing them there so happy and so proud, like, it's priceless.
No, I was pissed.
Who wants to be my WrestleMania tag partner?
Moved us down to the first throw and he was supposed to pick somebody out of the crowd. That's up there, pick me, pick me, pick me. And he wouldn't even look at me. He walked by without even looking.
You! That's a child!
Nah, I gotta pick that little kid. Which is okay with me because I didn't want to get body slammed anyways.
As a kid, I like knowing like what my father did and how when he walked around, that people knew him. I said, I want that feeling. I want people to know me. I want to be remembered. But I'm thankful for the way that I was raised, that, no, you can have whatever you want, but you're going to work for it.
We did what we could raising him, and we hope we instilled in him our values. So when he did get on, do on his own, he knew what was going on, and evidently it worked.
I am a country boy. I was born country, I live country, I'll die country, and I have the coolest job on the earth. That's all there is to it.
Our little boy.
Yeah.
He's grown into a great man.
Been done a long way.
Yeah. We've done something right.
Yeah, I said the apple didn't fall far from the tree. It just got a little bit bigger.
I'm almost as tall as you now.
Yeah.
You must be shrinking and I'm stretching.
Something like that. It is hot out here.
It's hot. That's one thing the shares do.
Sweat.
That was the first basketball team I was on.
She was trying to blend in. Boom. If you get in her way, oh, boom.
She's the one who taught me that. Elbows up, elbows up.
Hello, my name is Renate Fanini, and my daughter is WWE's superstar Nia Jax.
In Carlsbad, I think it helped me be more understanding of a lot of things. We weren't the richest family.
Thanks.
We were definitely rich in love, yeah. We were cash poor, but we were definitely rich in love.
I was born in a very small town in Germany, which is called Bensberg. Then when I was 18, the Australian embassy was advertising for people to come and migrate to Australia. And I always wanted to learn English. Stayed a total of 17 years in Australia. Nias and her older brother, they were born in Sydney, Australia. Then their dad wanted to move to Hawaii. But so then we lived in Hawaii for 6 years, and then we moved to Carlsbad in 91.
my mom has always made it like a big point of us being very close. Like she even said when we were younger, I don't care what happens between like anybody in your life, no matter what, you're always close to your brothers. Like they're everything.
And I think that closeness of us growing up together and being together and having to, you know, a lot of times watch out for ourselves and, you know, our parents are working and stuff like that. All those experiences you go through struggle, you go through hanging out, and keeps you close.
And being the older sister, oh my, I was very protective over my younger brother. Very protective and like made sure he, because he was also the one who liked to test the waters and like get into trouble and stuff like that. So I always make sure I like protected him and like took care of him. And
we just beat him up pretty much. that was a brunt of it. He never could fight back. He always lost.
Growing up in Carlsbad, I made some amazing friends there and great people, great atmosphere. I mean, perfect weather. We were on the beach every summer.
And sports, it's kind of a bond that you build and you make great relationships with other friends since we came from different towns and countries. And it was important for me to move to Carlsbad so my kids could go to a school and grow up and build friendships. Wholesomeness, that's what it's about.
When I first got here, they didn't have girls basketball, and I wanted to play basketball. My dad wanted me to play, so I had to play with the boys. Obviously, being the only girl, like, the boys didn't think that I was good enough, and they didn't think they could pass me the ball. You know, they didn't really expect me to be as good as they were.
When she made a three-pointer in the middle of the field, and the whole gym went, a girl did that?
And same with baseball, you know, like I played baseball and they didn't have a girls team.
She hit a home run, they all, this girl threw the home run, you know, and it was amazing. And at the time I didn't even realize the impact. You know, this is just my daughter playing a game, but people were just so in awe of this talented girl.
She rose the occasion and it brought out her natural abilities and it made her believe in herself more, I think, you know, that she could compete no matter what.
Unbelievable. Everybody wanted to be playing with her. And I remember the coaches and teachers, they used to come up to me. Oh my gosh, your daughter just creamed us at lunch playing basketball.
When I did finally actually start playing with girls competitively in junior high and high school, I realized I had a little bit of an edge. And not only just being bigger, but I was stronger and just a little bit, you know, more agile than what the girls were used to. But I definitely was made fun of for looking different and being a different size than everybody. No matter what, it affected me. You know, no matter what, it was always going to be something that I took with me when it came to like high school and there was homecoming dances and I wasn't asked to any of the dances. And like, those are the kind of things that were in the back of my head. It was like, oh, it's because I'm the bigger girl and, you know, I'm not the cute girl. I'm not the pretty little girl that, you know, all the boys like.
When she was playing basketball in the gym in Carlsbad, one of, I guess, a talent agent for modeling, he wanted her to model, and I said, what the heck is that, you know? But she moved to New York, and they put her up in the model housing, and she did for plus-size modeling, but she was very homesick.
I always had in the back of my mind, like, I didn't just want to model, not that anything was wrong with it, but I was like, I always need, and that was something my mom always instilled, like, you always have to have a degree, like, you need something to back you up. And I finished out my schooling at Cal State San Marcos, and I got my business degree.
She worked in the bank and stuff, and then she went to WrestleMania, and then what happened? And here we are.
We are here in the Iron Paradise. We are clanging and banging. I'm here with my cousin Lena, also known around the world in the WWE as Nia Jax. This woman has the potential to be one of the most dominant female superstar the WWE has ever seen through hard work. Right. I'm sharing my experience with her.
Yes, you taught me how to be the hardest worker in the room.
Hardest worker in the room.
That's right.
My aunt Atta and her son, my cousin, Dwayne The Rock Johnson, were the ones who actually kind of, you know, pushed me to get into wrestling. It's something that, you know, High Chief Peter Maivia started for our family. I'm so honored to continue the legacy, but I'm glad that I get to blaze my own trail in it. Went to WrestleMania 28 to go see Dwayne come back and fight John Cena. And I was sitting front row with my aunt, and energy was just insane. I looked at my aunt, I was like, do you think I could do something like this? I'm like, I don't see anybody like me. And she said, you are exactly what this company needs. Somebody like you needs to go into this company and show that the world that like a bigger, beautiful, strong woman can do this. She's like, I think you'd be great for it.
As soon as she found out that she had a tryout, we just started training. I would take her over to high school I was coaching at. We'd do like get-ups and rolling, and we'd run through some agility drills.
I had the 3-day tryout, and like I was instantly addicted to the feeling of stepping into the ring once I got there. Once I did it, I called my mom. I was like, I have to do this. This is for me. Like, I need to do this.
I went, Lena, really? You have everything going here. But I'm very selfish. I didn't want my children to leave. And I still don't want them to leave. And I didn't believe it, you know? I know she has the talents and she has the looks and she has everything. But I know it's a hard lifestyle. It's, you know, and they go, go, go. And but Atta and Dwayne, they're so encouraging. I knew they would take care of her. That was very reassuring to me.
My mom was always super supportive. Even though she missed me, she was super proud of everything I did. She just, ugh. She's the most amazing person. With all the sacrifice she's ever made, that's all I want, is for her to just be proud. Found out when my debut match was gonna happen in NXT.
She flew me into Orlando, and we went together to the NXT event. Oh, the atmosphere is just nothing like it that I experienced, you know?
I can't tell you how much curiosity has penetrated the NXT universe about the debut of Nia Jax, and to see firsthand what she can bring to the table.
Remember when I walked out onto the ramp and I walked down and I saw her face? She was literally like the first person standing at the ramp with like a camera.
Vroom. Took a lot of reassurance from her that she's gonna be okay.
And then she got to see like all the support we have down there, you know, like I introduced her to my coaches, and she just saw how supportive and loving our coaches are. And you know, WWE is our family. And so she saw that I was taken care of, and she's like, oh, I don't think you're coming home. She's like, this is for you. Gosh.
You're my rock. You're my rock.
Literally, just the other day, I put a picture up of me winning a very amazing award, and like the first two comments on there is fat and disgusting. And it's just like, oh gosh, like going back to growing up, my mom's always, you know, told me beauty comes from within, and always stay true to yourself no matter what. You want to stay true to yourself. Going through the process of WWE and like coming up in the company and realizing the platform that we had, I just continued to spread that message because that's who I am.
She called and she cried. She said, Mom, I can't believe it. And I said, you can't believe it. I can't believe it. The voice called me and I said, oh my gosh.
That is what it represents more than anything. You know, not that I just hold the title, but it's, you know, what I fought for out there. You know, the message I want to send to everybody, and the message I want to send to young boys and girls and all of, you know, everybody around the world, to stand up for themselves, you know, never take the crap, never be bullied or feel less than, or let anybody make you feel insecure about yourself.
to me, she says, oh, it's going to be my daughter, my baby. You know, in fact, we went somewhere once and somebody said, oh, she's Nia Jax. I said, tonight she's my daughter. She said, Mom, don't do that.
But you know what I always realized? That my differences made me unique. I want to hear you guys all say, I am beautiful. You guys are all beautiful. And we don't stand up for bullying, do we? The lineage that, you know, my Samoan family has here in the WWE, it's amazing. It's a legacy that, like, I'm proud of, that I get to add to it in such a cool, different way.
Going all the way back to Peter Mayfield, the original High Chief, who started this entire dynasty, and through his grandson, Dwayne Johnson, now through his grandniece, my daughter, Nia Jax. As a dad, extremely proud.
I know how rich of a culture it is, and I know how like deeply rooted it is in Samoans to like be prideful of who they are. And I hope it makes somewhat of a difference of what I'm doing. And oh God, that's great. I never even thought of it like that, but that's cool. Yeah, I hope that I do. I'm proud. Jeez.
I raised my children to always, no matter who or what you are, do what you can. Give your best, no matter what. You know, and she wants everybody to be treated equal. Everybody's good. It's good in everybody. It's a nice country western song, actually. I don't know the name. Luke Bryant. I believe there's good in everybody. I love that song.
For me, I'm in a dream, you know? I know it's real, but to me, it's not real. I just see her. I want to hang out on the couch with her, and I want to watch movies. And
you are, Mom. You, like, literally have fought for everything in our entire life. Fought for us to be here. Fought for me to never have to worry about a thing. And now I get to reap the benefits of all her hard work.
But it's only because you're working on me now.
And that's because I got it from you.
She's shutting me down.
Just the love and the appreciation strangers from all over the world show to my daughter. How can anybody live up to that? You know, you can be only humble and say, thank you, thank you, thank you, give the love. She's just amazing. She's beyond amazing, really.
Finn likes his dad to collect him at the airport and bring him home.
Taxi in the rent.
When he's going to the gym, although he's going down to the gym to do 2 or 3 hours in the gym, he hasn't got the energy to walk to the gym, and he hasn't got the energy to walk home from the gym, so dad has to drive him to the gym and be on standby to get a text to collect him from the gym. My name is Fintan Devitt, and this is Leonie, my wife. We've 5 children. Finn is the second boy of 4 boys, and we have Anne-Marie in the middle. Leonie and I are both from Bray, where we live today, and we've lived here for 38 years. The boys and Anne-Marie all grew up very happy children in this area. Well, as a young Finn, he was always a very happy child. Full of fun, but he lived on the edge as well. Very much into soccer and Gaelic games. From an early stage, showed a lot of interest in wrestling. When he worked in the local supermarket after school, all the money was put to buy wrestling gear. Like, he had every tape, every video, all the figures, rings, everything. Everything was spent on wrestling.
What's left over from my childhood, Power Slam was a magazine that came out once a month, and I would run home from school to the newsagents to get this, and I would read it cover to cover, and it was literally the only thing I would read. This was like my Bible.
When we go to teachers' meetings, they always bring up the little thing about the wrestling, so they all knew that he was into the wrestling. When it came to essays, he was writing about wrestling. And
he was a good student in school. He was behaviour-wise, his reports were always very good, and his art reports were always very good, so very well liked in school.
When he told us early on that he wanted to be a wrestler, we told him to follow his dream. And if that's what he wanted, we supported him all the way.
When we were younger, he was very hands-on with his, I suppose, his own training regime that he started.
I may have been a little bit disobedient.
When me and my other brother Owen, we were very young, he would practice a lot on us.
The powerbomb used to be his favourite.
We had an older couch in this sitting room, and he used to be able to take the base pillows off it, and they'd be laid out on the floor here.
And because he couldn't practice the moves on me, I'd be sent out to keep an eye out to see if it was my mother coming back.
Yeah, you'd get about 12, 15 power bombs in a row.
Power bomb, razor's edge, even a good old Davey Boy Smith power slam.
I made rings for him and helped him with all his equipment, put shows together and got lights. Here on, our other son always worked doing the sound and the lighting. And Anne-Marie used to do the door, collect the money at the door from time to time.
I think everybody in this household was always raised to support each other. You know, especially with my chosen kind of dream, it might have been a little bit out there for some people.
Regularly we got phone calls from the school, from the career guidance or teachers that were taking interest in him, and they'd say, Finn is telling us that he wants to be a wrestler, saying you better come down and talk to us. Like, he's not going to be a wrestler. You're going to have to talk to him. He's going to have to find a career. We'd go to the meetings with them and we'd say, no, he's going to be a wrestler. And they'd be amazed.
Just say, well, that's what he wants to do, so let's support him, you know. You know, I'm sure if I wanted to be a postman or a fireman, it would have been the exact same. So I don't see why it should be any different if I want to be a pro wrestler.
When he sets his mind on something, it doesn't matter, he'll follow it, and he'll do everything in his power to try and make sure that it comes to fruition.
Fergal Devitt, just relentless!
Just hard work and determination. And
ladies and gentlemen, here is your winner, Fergal Devitt!
Getting the opportunity to go to Japan. A lot of people would have shied away from that because he was going to a country that he was never in before. We visited Japan quite a lot and went to a lot of shows.
Yeah, the first time we saw him on the stage in Japan, that was, you know, amazing because it was the very first time on a big show, so it was brilliant.
I always remember my dad getting really excited, like overly excited. My mum, quite the contrast, was always visually very worried about perhaps possible injuries or, you know, mishaps.
No, I never thought about the danger part of it. Never thought about that. Just, he was happy doing it, so.
You used to get a bit worried when you were ringside in Japan, though, didn't you?
In Japan?
The one at Sumo Arena, it was actually a tag team match. I got knocked out of the ring and my dad leaned through the fence and said, come on, get up, you can do it. And in the exact same breath, my mum said, oh, are you okay? Will you be okay? So,
No, I was never worried, Val.
My name is Finn Balor. And I'm here at NXT because I'm bringing something you've never seen before.
We're very happy that Finn has joined the WWE and is being very successful in it.
Coup de grace! Finn Balor is NXT champion!
We were very happy that he was in America. That's what he wanted, and he was following his dream.
Hello.
It was actually wonderful. See his big billboard outside, and we were blown away. Couldn't believe it.
This is great.
To get down there on the night of the show, everybody, you know, was so good and talking to us about him.
Like he said before me, you raised him right.
He's a good looking kid too. but he's
don't know where he got it from.
From his mother, of course.
To be in that setting, it was amazing.
Seth Rollins lands on his feet. Balor, though, on his as well. Drives Rollins into the corner. Finn Balor's feeling it.
All of a sudden, there it was happening in front of our eyes.
We've got a new WWE Universal Champion!
It gave me goosebumps. I knew that he was very happy. It was just a dream come true.
And ladies and gentlemen, we begin tonight with breaking news. Last night, Finn Balor suffered a torn labrum, which will require surgery, and he'll be out of action at least 6 months.
I actually knew that he got injured as it happened. And Leonie, on a number of occasions, said to me, he's in pain. We knew that because we'd watched him so many times at shows that we knew that he wasn't comfortable. I couldn't believe that Finn carried on. He would see the show going on more important than him being treated for an injury. That would be normal for him. Not only himself and us, but everybody around was devastated. Well, following on from his surgery, we stayed with him in Orlando for a couple of weeks. Every day was so positive. A couple of days after, he said to me, this isn't the end. He said, this is only the beginning.
My parents have supported me everywhere I've went. UK to Japan, NXT, from the smallest shows in Ireland in front of like 15-20 people. It wasn't until the surgery, that's when I really appreciated just how much I needed them there, because, you know, the first 2-3 weeks after the surgery, they were really tough. And I don't think I would have got through it as well as I did without having them there by my side. So I'm very grateful for that.
Leonie and I are very proud of him and how well he's done. All the achievements that he's achieved today.
It hasn't changed him at all. Yeah, I think he just loves to get home, and he's always so happy when he's here and just to chill out. And
good size, yeah.
How old was I in that one?
He has a nice few friends, and then his brothers and sisters will be always in and out, so he'd see everybody, you know. And he loves his mammy's cooking.
I think it's very important to never forget where you came from. But it's, for me, it's just as important to keep coming back to where I came from to reinforce that.
To see what's going on today with all the cameras and the crew, it kind of brings home exactly how well he's doing and how good he's doing. So it's probably a sign of success. And all we hope is that there is success and future success.
She's always been wanting the attention of everybody. She was center stage with everything.
All the children of the world.
I always told him from the time she was young, with her personality, I said she's either going to be successful in some sort of either entertainment, or we're going to be supporting her the rest of her life.
Mommy.
What?
Can we go videotape my room? What you did to it?
Oh, yeah.
I'm Bob.
I'm Angela, and our daughter is WWE superstar Alexa Bliss.
Lexi, do something cute for the camera.
Since the time that she was born, of course, she had to make a grand entrance. She was a month early.
We had her young. I was 17, she was 18. So when we started, it was a struggle. You know, at the beginning, we got, you know, the smallest apartment we could get and pinched every penny to be able to pay bills. But later on, we started a business that ended up being fairly successful. So then we were able to provide more. We moved to a suburb in Columbus and, you know, out of the small apartment in the city.
Ohio will always be home.
My bedroom, that window up there. This is the driving range. Me and my friends would go out and play flashlight tag or hit the golf balls back the other direction. Terrible golfer, by the way. Terrible.
I see you.
I see you too.
She was involved in a lot of different sports. We always tried to keep her involved so that she had something to do after school on the weekends. So she started off when she was younger in gymnastics. She was watching TV when she was four and it was the Olympics were on, and she's standing in front of the TV with her little hand on her hip telling us, oh, that looks easy.
The relationship with my parents I've always had, we've always been really close, basically giving me all the tools I needed to succeed. My dad coached my softball team. They're like, you know what, you need to learn to defend yourself, so we're gonna put you in kickboxing. So then I did kickboxing, and then that transitioned into all-star cheer. I got to go to Worlds for competitive all-star cheerleading, and that's like the Olympics of cheerleading. And so we all went, and it was in Disney World. And Disney has always been, you know, a special place in my heart. Every year we've gone since I was 3 years old. It was our family thing that we always did. And so just kind of having those moments and knowing that it's like little mini family vacations, it's really cool.
You were so proud of your teeth being gone.
I'm doing the Miss America wave.
Look how proud you are of it. You're like making sure that the top and bottom are showing.
Yeah, my mom is definitely more than just my mom. I mean, growing up, she was super strict. She wasn't my friend, and she used to tell me that all the time. She'd be like, I'm not your friend, I'm your mother. But then the older I got, you know, I kind of grew up with her. We kind of grew up together because she had me at such a young age, and now she's my best friend, and I don't know what I would do without her.
Do you remember when I texted you?
Hold on, sorry, I got, like, something on my lip.
You're the worst! No, it's not.
Well, I just bit it off, but it was sticking up, and I felt it hit my other lip.
Anyways.
She had battled an eating disorder since she was 15 years old. We had almost lost her at one point.
They told me that we were going to church. So we get in the car, and I think we're going to church, and we actually show up at the hospital. They take my vital signs, and they immediately tell my parents, they're like, we're gonna keep your daughter with or without your consent because she's 24 hours away from dying. You know, I'm terrified. It's just very, it was a very scary moment, and my mom just stood behind me, and she's like, I'm so sorry, but we have to do this. And she's like, you're gonna stay here for a while, and you're gonna get better. And after, you know, weeks and weeks and weeks in the hospital, it wasn't really for the actual eating disorder. It was because I was having issues, you know, with my heart rate coming back and all this stuff. And I just remember my parents were there every single day, and my mom slept in the hospital on the couch. And she would just sit with me and talk to me and tell me how proud of me she was every bite that I would take, and just help me really, you know, come back into who I really was and not let this, you know, take control of me, because they told me that, you know, 1 in 4 people die of anorexia, and I was closest to that one. My mom just looks at me and she goes, I don't want your life to amount to a statistic. You're gonna be that person that passes away from this and people will learn from your mistakes. And she said, do you really want your life to be that? Do you wanna be a statistic? And then that's kind of that moment where I was just like, oh crap. You know, like, no. All right, we're here at my old cheer gym where I basically lived Step 1 All-Stars in Columbus. Yeah.
It's kind of bigger than the last time you were here, right?
Yeah. Yeah, so Stephanie has known me since middle school. She was there for when I was doing All-Star cheer. She was there for me through my eating disorder.
That is true.
Yes. She actually kicked me off the team.
Kick you off the team. That is a true statement. I had to be the tough one that would say, no, you can only come back when you hit this weight, or you can only come back when you're able to do this skill, which were easy skills for her, but became very challenging skills for her because of the things that she had gone through health-wise. Well, of course, our girl bounced back perfectly, and she got to compete her senior year with us and go to the World Championship, where she found herself on the cover of American Cheerleader magazine, and just made us overall super proud.
When she went away to college, the eating disorder came back. So she went and got treatment and was hospitalized. And when she came out, you know, she kept saying, I know that I need to gain weight, but I need to do it in a healthy way. Well, when she was younger, we had friends that were bodybuilders, and she had always said that she wanted to do that.
So I had trained with my trainer, Natalie Callan, since I was 15 years old. And I went to her and I said, I need help. You know, that's probably like the hardest thing you could ever ask somebody, like, I need help. She got me in touch with her colleague, Mike Davies, and they sat me down and they said, okay, 5 weeks there's a show. There's a Natural Ohio show.
You're either gonna gain the weight and have muscle and get out there and do well, or you're gonna go out there stick thin and embarrass yourself. But you're getting on that stage.
And I ended up taking first place in my class and then first place all around. Ended up becoming one of the youngest pros to get a pro card. And I didn't necessarily really wanted to keep competing pro, but I just really wanted a pro card and just be like, yeah, did it.
Mom, I know what I'm going to do now. She said, just hear me out. I'm trying out for the WWE, and I think my exact words may have been, the hell you are.
I liked watching wrestling because I really thought it was very intriguing. Rey Mysterio, he really caught my eye because his, you know, wrestling style, which was lucha, it reminded me of gymnastics because he was like flipping around and doing all these really cool moves, and I naturally gravitated towards that. I remember going on WWE.com, and then that's when I found the link. You want to be a WWE superstar? And I said, yes, I do. So I clicked on it and paid to have a video made, sent that in, and just kind of hoped for the best.
I figured if she wanted to do it, she could figure it out and get it done. I don't think she was too happy about it.
No. Girls like China, Lexi, China. You cannot stand in a ring with China. She was like, Mom, you know, I've done so many sports. It's athletics. I can do this.
And I was signed and moved to Orlando. You know, my family was moving to Florida at the same time, coincidentally, and it kind of sped up the process of us all moving down to Florida.
As I mentioned before, I owned a business, and we had always thought about moving to Florida once I sold the business, so it kind of worked out and it made sense to make that move.
There was no way my kid was moving to another state without us. Yeah. It was very, very overwhelming at first. She came in, you know, the new girl that didn't have wrestling experience.
I came home and I would cry and I said, this isn't for me. I can't, it's so hard. The girls that I'm with, they're so good.
And I would just tell her, you know, Lex, look what you've done in gymnastics, look what you've done in cheerleading, look what you've done in bodybuilding. All of those things, when you decided that you loved it and you wanted to be the best, you worked. He said, this is no different. You will be able to do exactly what you've done in every other sport.
Me and my mom is kind of really what we bonded over. I felt like I really needed her support because I didn't know what I was getting myself into.
It was one of those things that, you know, I kind of ended up being her biggest cheerleader through this, even though I was the one absolutely against it in the beginning.
When I'm around, life is bliss.
That's our Lex.
Yeah.
I still am highly obsessed with things that are sparkly. It is what it is.
Every time she'd come out, I'd just smile.
Enzo and Cass appear to be on their way to capturing the NXT Tag Team Championship. It's Alexa Bliss! Alexa Bliss grabbing hold of Enzo from the top rope!
Yep, most hated. Growing up, she's always been so dramatic. So I felt like once she actually got to come out of who she is and feel like that she had more freedom to kind of do things that aren't her.
How dare you!
I knew that eventually she would do well. I knew it.
This is the WWE Draft, and 6 draft picks will be made off the NXT roster.
My daughter, I'm like, oh yeah, she definitely should be one of them. And Lexi's like, Mom, there's only 6. Don't get your hopes up. She's like, but I'm really hopeful too, you know.
On SmackDown, let's see what we got on deck. Alexa Bliss from NXT.
Very impressive in the women's division in NXT. I think this is just what she needs for her career.
I was an emotional wreck because I was so happy and I just wanted to hug her so bad in that moment because I know how hard she worked to get there.
Emotional side of me gone. The women of SmackDown better get ready because I may be small, but I am fierce.
Our favorite musical is Legally Blonde, and there's this part and it says, hey, Mom, that's my name in black and white. Your daughter must be doing something right. And she sent me that picture with that quote, and she said, that's my name in blue and white. Your daughter's doing something right. And I lost it.
I mean, there was times, you know, I was thinking that maybe this isn't for me. I was getting frustrated. I was emotional. And if it weren't for my parents telling me, you know, you can do this, and pushing me, even from when I was little.
Go, Lex, you can do it.
My friends used to tell them, you know, you're wasting your money. You're wasting your money having her do gymnastics. You're wasting your money having her do cheer, bodybuilding, all this stuff, but it's all led me to where I am today.
You're gonna cut a promo on how I'm gonna beat Becky at TLC for the SmackDown Women's title.
This is very intimidating.
It is, right? But you have to play to this camera right here.
Oh, Miss Becky Lynch, your days with my daughter's title are numbered.
And just like that, we have a new SmackDown Women's Champion. Her name is Alexa Bliss.
Everything that we had gone through, whether it was in gymnastics, cheer, my eating disorder, you know, and my parents saying to me, you know, what are you gonna do with your life? Do you wanna be a statistic or do you wanna make something of your life? And the fact that they were able to be here for one of my biggest accomplishments in my career, it all makes up for it now. I can't even put it into words. It's great.
It didn't surprise me that she was able to do it because she'd always been able to kind of accomplish anything she set her mind to. She was 110% in it.
I feel she deserves everything that she gets because I saw the struggle and I saw her work so hard. And, you know, coming in without that background and having to come from behind to get to where she is, I'm so proud.
Smile for real.
Okay, can't help it. My awkward smile. Okay.
That was awkward too.
I can't do it.
There you go.
Okay.
Right now?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm George Mizanin.
Hello, I'm Barbara.
We're Michael's parents. The WWE.
Great job, Dad. Great job.
Okay.
Yep.
I'm George.
Hi, Barbara.
We're the parents of the WWE, The
Mike
Miz.
The Miz.
Thanks. The WWE.
Mike the Miz. We're the parents of Mike the Miz.
Yeah. I'm George.
I'm Barbara. And we are the parents of Mike the Miz.
That's good.
Okay.
Bravo.
Very good. Very good.
To let you guys know exactly just how my parents are, my mom thinks I've never done anything wrong in my entire life, that I am perfect.
It takes an exceptional person to prove everyone wrong. This is champion! And I did just that.
Are you proud of me?
You're my Michael.
My father, on the other hand.
I always thought he was kind of average. Never expected this to happen with him, ever. I mean, I've been surprised my whole life with him.
Thanks, Dad.
What? That was special.
I've been average my entire life. No.
Michael was a very active child. He was the biggest ham.
Michael. Hey, have I been good or not?
Sometimes.
Trying to steal the show, whether he was a child, a teenager, or as Mike the Miz, he always steals the show.
Look at that bow tie. Look at that handsome little devil, huh? Karate, yeah, black belt.
Really dedicated himself to everything that he liked.
Michael was a perfectionist and very competitive.
Basketball was his sport.
I thought he was just an average player, but he tried hard. He was on varsity.
You weren't a superstar.
I was pretty good. I mean, I was captain of the baseball team.
Yes, but you never played.
I played. I was a pitcher. You don't play every game when you're a pitcher.
Wow. He is not average. He is way above average.
Thank you, Mom.
Your first day of school, you were so excited to go to school. You liked school. You wanted to get up. You could never be late for school.
When he was a teenager, that's when he really got into wrestling, and he'd have all his friends come over every Sunday for the pay-per-views. And that's where you...
Pay-per-views.
Pay-per-view. Okay.
The Mega Power Exposed here at WrestleMania 5.
I went to WrestleMania in Atlanta City. So on the way home on the plane, I signed some autographs and gave it to Mike. He took it to show and tell.
8 years old, my dad signs autographs. No one knew that it was my dad, and I didn't even know it was my dad until I opened it again and looked at the autographs, and I realized that was my dad's handwriting, and my dad conned me. Conned his 8-year-old son into believing that Randy Savage, Hulk Hogan, and Honky Tonk Man all signed his program at WrestleMania 5.
Pretty good, huh?
And to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Normandy High School was my backbone. It was kind of the place that taught me you could be anything. I loved high school. I was president of student government. I gave such a speech that my dad actually helped me with. And because I told him the speech, and he was like, you shouldn't do that. You should do it like this. And then I did that speech, and I won. I became student government president.
If you are not in a winner's spot, you should be in attendance. Please see Mr. Brandel with any questions.
And the Miz is here, right here, the Miz.
To everyone out there, do your homework, get straight A's, and have as much fun as possible. It's Normandy High School, and you guys are awesome! Now in there is our basketball court, where I played basketball. I wasn't the best. I did try the hardest. I remember my dad sitting in the stands yelling at our coach. Have him tell you about the time that he yelled at the coach and what happened the next year.
The coach is making all these bad decisions and I'm yelling. A coach turned around and looked at me and said, would you like to run the team? I said, absolutely. He says, come on down. So I came down there and he kicked me out of the game.
Next year, your tryouts, what happened?
Michael got cut from the team because the coach didn't like me.
Right now we are at my dad's Mr. Hero on Ridge and Denison. And this was my first job. I was legit flipping burgers on that grill, putting fries down, wafer fries, which are the best.
He did whatever he wanted to. I didn't really care. I mean, it was like I wanted him to have some good work habits. That wasn't his forte. He didn't like the restaurant business. He went, what?
I was your hardest worker.
I'm surprised you even knew how to cook.
Nobody better than me. Nobody faster.
6 years.
Yeah, flipped burgers. You're acting like I fell asleep the entire time. Kidding me? I ran that place for you.
You quit.
I ran that. What do you mean I quit? I went to college.
Gotta say, I haven't lost my touch.
So after the real world, I was like, what do you want, Mike? What do you want to do with your life?
His main thing in life, he always talked about, was WWE, being a wrestler.
It's a Mizanin family tradition, if you will. Christmas Eve party, and they got me this. And so it kind of gave me motivation to, like, it gave me a thing where, like, that's where I want to be, where my family's behind me.
Never in my wildest dreams did I ever think he would succeed, and I thought he was too small, but tough enough. That was the shocker of my life.
Hoorah, baby, step into my reality.
But with the Tough Enough, went to every library. I passed out about probably 50,000 flyers because it was online voting. And
so she kind of cheated to let him win.
No, I did not cheat.
She was supporting him
50, all the way, 100%.
That's not cheating.
Okay, never mind.
Vote for me.
Then when he went into WWE, I sat there and thought, you know, he's living his dream right now, and that's good.
It was like so surreal.
I am the future. The face of this company.
You could see he had talent. Well, I remember his first action figure. Oh my God, I went crazy. That was probably one of the most exciting things. My kid has an action figure.
I can tell you which my most memorable of them is. My dad laughing while I'm getting my handed to me by Randy Orton.
That was hilarious. I wasn't laughing, I just didn't know what to do. I mean, that's kind of embarrassing when somebody's beating your kid up in front of you and putting him in front of you, and I'm saying, what are you supposed to do?
Not laugh?
Randy Orton has blown a gasket.
From Cleveland, Ohio,
The Miz.
Main event at WrestleMania, it was huge. I couldn't believe it, very proud. That's when I met The Rock, and I met his mother, and it was like Michael got mad at me because I forgot about him for a minute, okay?
When you were backstage at the Hall of Fame, and what I told you not to do.
Oh, pictures. I was in the picture-taking mode, and I was taking pictures of everybody, and I wasn't—
Were you asking to take a picture of him?
No, I was just taking pictures.
So Michael had to take his camera away.
Meanwhile, I told him not to take pictures with people because they're working.
I got a bunch of pictures of Rock, his mother, family. It was fun.
Yeah, where's that? Where's there he is?
Right over there.
This is Dad. There he is.
I'm a born entertainer. I enjoy being in front of the camera. I enjoy entertaining the audiences worldwide each and every week.
The prodigal son of Cleveland, The Miz.
He's done very, very well for himself. I mean, with the WWE, never in a million years would I think he would be where he's at today.
I am proud of the man that he has become. He's not average.
You applied yourself, worked at it, and you're doing very, very well. You're far above average now. Now you're a superstar. Now you're one of the best, I think. The difference between Mike and The Miz, they're almost complete opposites. Mike is really a low-key guy. The Miz is conceited, complete opposites, I think.
You are in basically my mom's shrine room of Mike as well as The Miz, AKA, as she likes to call me, my Michael.
The Miz is a character he created. My Michael is humble, he's kind, he's generous, and always will be. And he'll always be my Michael.
Give it up for my parents, Cleveland!
Is that a wrap?
Yeah.
you were a little redhead at first.
Strawberry blonde.
Yeah,
right? Wasn't I? What is that?
That was the style then.
That was back
the
in the
style.
Day.
Style. When did you get rid of that mustache? You should probably bring it back.
They are coming back now. That and beards.
Oh, geez, who's that on the toilet?
Oh, my God.
My name is Rich Saccomano.
My name is Mary Saccomano.
Our daughter is a WWE superstar, Mandy Rose.
For Amanda to grow up here in Yorktown was fun. She was young when we moved into this house.
Well, it was pretty awesome. It's a little suburban town, but...
You should say growing up in Yorktown.
Oh, yeah, thanks.
Bro,
I have to go against my dad now. I know.
That's unbelievable.
He just gave me a... Did you hear that?
No, I didn't hear it.
He just makes you say growing up in Yorktown. You got to repeat the question. Something you didn't really
do. Yeah.
She has three older brothers, and it's an experience. I mean, I was happy to finally get a daughter out of the deal, so. My sons are great, but it's probably where all the gray hair came from, so.
She got along, you know, well with her brothers.
Obviously, there's pros and cons because they were, you know, very overprotective over me, but it's just the way they were. I was the youngest, and I was their little sister. They used to be very, like, sensitive of, like, what they said in front of me. And I remember my older brother always just being like, don't talk like that in front of her.
She had a hard time making friends with boys. You know, not in a bad way, but, you know, they were kind of tough on her. Fortunately, she was a bit of a tomboy as a kid. So she was able to take care of herself. She, you know, she didn't take too much crap from anybody.
So my one brother, Gary, he would always joke around because he was this little, like, skinny, scrawny thing. And we used to, like, arm wrestle all the time, and I'd always beat him, and he'd hate it, but, like, he was, I don't know, I probably could still beat him today, to this day.
Well, I think in some ways she was always Daddy's little girl, but,
She almost knocked Gary's teeth out one day. Yeah, because he beat her to the sink or something. He was standing
right
on a stool, and she just
cross-body
blocked him right off the stool, so. You know, so she knew how to handle herself, and like I said, she was good at manipulation. I mean, you know, if I heard them going at it, my natural instinct was to run to my daughter's side.
They tease me a lot, and it was just what siblings do, you know. Called me Hamburgers, which the whole world knows my nickname is Hamburgers.
I never understood it. They
well,
still tease her about it now.
I guess I just really liked Hamburgers, and my brother thought it was funny to call me Hamburgers.
I think it started with the barbecue, and she had one hamburger, and then the boys were laughing because she had asked her dad for another one.
I was running from high school. I was a freshman, and Gary was a sophomore, and I was trying to make the bus. And this kid that was in Gary's grade, he put down the window, and he screamed out, "Hey, Hamburgers!" He's like, "You gonna make the bus?" And I'm just like, I look up, and I'm like, oh my God. I'm like, now the whole bus, all of his friends are calling me Hamburgers? Like, how embarrassing, like, nobody's gonna like me. The relationship I have with Gary, actually, we're very close. We're only 18 months apart. Like, I'll never forget the one story. He found out I had a boyfriend in eighth grade, and we were leaving eighth period from the middle school, and our middle school is right next to the high school. And I see my brother like kind of like walking with his friends. He's like, come on, guys. And I'm like, I have a weird feeling too right away. I'm like, I don't know what he's doing because I think I'm like holding hands with this boy, you know? And my brother just comes running and just punches him right in the face. Literally, and I'm just like, oh my gosh. And my brother's like, don't talk to my sister. Like, you know, don't even go, don't even look at her. And I'm just like, okay, this is gonna be, and this is like me in eighth grade, like about to go to high school, like super excited, like little boy crazy at this time. I'm like, wow, I'm probably never gonna have a boyfriend because of my brother. Cool, this is gonna be my life.
We were very involved with the school in terms of sports. They all had participated in sports to some degree. Amanda was a big basketball player, you know, so she thinks.
Oh, no. Well, more of a dancer, though,
but she,
too.
But she danced. She actually migrated over to dance as she got a little older and stuck with that. It was interesting because, you know, as she got older, you know, the tomboyish stuff started leaving. She was turning into a young woman. And that's when I really started to worry.
I never really gave him any trouble. I remember having a little bit I feared my father a little bit more because he was old school, conservative, and strict.
You know, I gotta say, I'll be honest with you, I never really had an issue with my daughter making bad choices. I had to be the tough Italian father, so.
My dad probably didn't like this. I don't know, oh, with the choker, I'm wearing it.
Choker.
The choker I was gonna rip off.
My mom was the one I can get away with basically anything, although she was a little tough when I was younger, like anything, the like curse words or anything, she put soap in our mouths and it was like the most disgusting thing ever. But that's like the only thing she did. It was just like, soap's going in your mouth. And like, what it was, wait till your father gets home. So literally like we just feared, my brothers and I, we all did. We feared my dad, obviously, because he was the strict one.
Well, we would have our times together, which was fun.
You know, I was really close with my mom. It was obviously the one I would go to for things because I was surrounded by men, my brothers and my dad. So, you know, as a young girl growing up, you have a lot of changes and stuff, and I would always go to my mom for a lot of that. This is it. Oh, yeah. This is the deli. Oh, I'm here to work. Yeah, right, imagine. Yeah, it was a lot of fun going to my dad's deli, especially when I was little.
This is usually like the common area that everyone comes to, pretty much. The hangout area, yeah.
She was 11 when she probably started hanging out a little bit there, but I mean, she went through a spell where, you know, I actually counted on her to, you know, to work, to do a job. And at one point, her and her three brothers, you know, were working together. It was probably the best time of my life, you know, having all the kids there working.
And I was a little hustler all the time, so like I wanted to work. I thought it was cool, you know? They wouldn't let me slice cold cuts or make sandwiches though, of course. Like I couldn't go near the food. And my brothers always used to be like, put your hair away, like put your hair back. They wanted me to wear a hairnet one time, and I said, absolutely not.
Overwhelming sometimes when they're all together. When you have 18 grandchildren and 14 great-grandchildren, that's quite a bit of family. So I'm always someone around me.
This Christmas she came back. She only had a couple days like home with all of us, and she was here helping my father out the day before Christmas Eve, I think we were here. So right back in the grind.
All right, butter roll. I can bring it to her. We do waiter service here too. It's the best butter roll you've ever had, okay? Careful, don't drop it. Okay, I'll help you. How can I bring it for you?
Pretty much did it all.
She was a hard worker.
You know, she was a smart girl. She went about things the right way, really developed her people skills.
Total of 11:38, please. Thank you.
She did very well for herself.
Got it.
She was moving on to her college years. You know, she spent 2 years at a community college, did well, and then went on to Iona to, you know, get her bachelor's degree in speech pathology.
In the process of trying to go to a master's, getting into a master's program, it was very competitive at the time. So I just kept working and, you know, I'll reapply next semester, whatever it was, until one of the girls at work was really into fitness. And she said, you should do this competing. So I got with her trainer and I started training. I was like, I started to feel really good about myself. I started to like see progress. And so she's like, do a show. It's all about stage presentation and marketability and not just like looking good. And I win, I get first place.
I always wanted to be supportive. You know, I raised her, I trusted her, and I was more concerned with her ability to handle like the criticism and everything that comes with that kind of competition.
For once in my life, I was like, wow, like this is like really cool, this could be something. I continued to do it and then went on to the world show and I won Bikini World Champion. A couple months go by, I get a call from a recruiter or from the CEO of WBFF that I competed with saying that they want to interview you for a reality show.
I'm ready, I'm tough enough.
This was all new to her. I mean, you know, yeah, she did fitness modeling, bikini modeling, did very well, but she never really did, you know, physical competition. And I said, let's see where this goes. You know, I was a little nervous that, you know, maybe she's gonna be disappointed.
Sonia and I still say to this day, that training was beyond anything we've ever experienced. We'd hit the ropes, we were all cut up, down our backs, like it was crazy. And then never would I thought like that day would come to where I am now.
I was surprised along with being afraid, God forbid, getting hurt. I was scared.
She had just gotten her bachelor's degree in speech pathology and was hunting around for a master's program. So I was still thinking that was the road she was gonna go down. So it was a big shock to me. And I eventually got on board and, you know, I'm not disappointed. I'm glad she followed her interests.
Just, you never know when you get these calls. Sometimes you just gotta go with it and see where it goes.
She got all the way down to, you know, the final round. And I still swear she should have won, but it worked out okay anyway. She just told me to watch TV. She didn't give anybody any specifics, but she said, make sure you tune in.
And from behind, Mandy Rose. You wanna burst on the scene and make an impact, this is how you do it.
That's when it hit me, and that's when I couldn't believe what I was watching. Mm-hmm. So that's my daughter on TV, you know, so.
They know how hard I worked in the performance center at NXT, even though it wasn't for that long, but you know, because I did come from a different background, and sometimes people have the wrong idea, like, oh, that she might not be in for this, she didn't, you know, love doing this her whole life, but you gotta work for it.
I was nervous until I went to a couple of shows, and each time I went, it got better and better, and I could tell how well she, you know, trained and, you know, was very serious about it, so.
Been in the stands, and I've heard, you know, I've had to listen to people be Mandy Rose fans and be Mandy Rose haters, and you know, so it's a little tough, but you take it with a grain of salt, you know, like, you want to turn around and tell them to shut up, it's my daughter, but you know, I understand that's the business. Grandkids get really excited, especially the two older boys, the two older boys. They're both very educated with WWE. Since she's gotten involved with it, Amanda's very well known in the elementary schools because everybody knows that, you know, it's their aunt, and you know, so it's pretty cool for them.
I'm really grateful for the places I get to go to. I get to travel around the world, out of the country on tour, and you know, it comes with not seeing your family that much, and now that I have all these nieces and nephews, like, you know, I miss some things, and like, it's hard, you know? Sometimes I get upset. You know, that is the one really hard thing. I miss my family a lot. For instance, last night in Brooklyn, seeing my nieces and nephews, the smile on their faces when they see me, and just when they see like everyone that, you know, they watch, and they're so like, literally like my little Richie, the oldest one, he just, his face, like when he saw Samoa Joe last night, and like, and he just was just like he has to turn around. He's like, you know, like he can't even take it. And it's just like, that's amazing.
And I know she's done several things with children, and she's posted stuff, and it really seems to make a difference in someone's life, which is really gratifying. So that makes me happy. You know, something besides, you know, in the ring, what she does outside.
And I could tell you, you know, as a father, you know, her sincerity is there, because she'll call me after an event like that. So I know her heart goes into it.
You know, I'm a role model to these kids, and especially the way that how far the business has come, and with the women especially too, you know, it's a great feeling.
She's got quite a fan club in the Carmel area, Carmel Mayapack area, that constantly ask about her. I mean, I had a fan come in last week. He says, you're Mandy Rose's family, right? It wasn't anything about the deli. It was all about Mandy Rose, you know? Here I'm trying to sell a ham sandwich, but.
Me now, guys. Making it big time.
Your town news.
Uh-uh. I get the front cover, you know?
Okay.
Wow. I only get front covers.
super grateful for everything that I've accomplished, and I just look at it like it's only up from here. Every day is a new day. There's always room for improvement. I mean, I've been really blessed, and I'm very humble too, though, because it, you know, I could sit back and also realize when something doesn't go my way, like, okay, like, you know, don't sweat the small stuff, like, it'll all be fine. And that's kind of the advice my parents will give me too.
But to think where she is now.
Yeah. Still is my little girl, and I'll probably always act like she's my little girl. Even though I know she's more than capable of taking care of herself, you know. So, you know, and the journey keeps getting better.
I was just showing her how to lock up. I'll lock up. Showing her how to lock up. Then I would just take her in. I would shoot her off the ropes.
Right? I mean.
Then she'd come in. And then from there, she'd take a nice hip toss.
Hi, I'm Paul Van Dale.
Hi, I'm Emily Van Dale.
And our daughter is WWE superstar Carmella.
Happy birthday, Leah.
Say goodbye, Leah.
Goodbye, Leah.
Hi, my name is Leah Van Dale, and I live on 46 Pickenhill Road.
Leah, hey, can you read your book?
I feel very fortunate because I grew up in a household with two parents who instilled in me in a very young age what it's like to live a healthy lifestyle. They're just so supportive of everything that my sister and I did, whether it was a dance recital or a dance competition or a high school play or a musical, whatever it was, they were always there and so supportive.
From the minute we brought her little sister home and she brought her home a little tricycle from the hospital, she thought she was wonderful.
They dance pretty much throughout their lives, and they pretty much always did everything together. And to this day, they get along great. That's one thing we're really thankful for, that we had two great kids that not only be sisters, but also be best friends too.
Every night it feels like we had a different show, whether it was a dance show or a fashion show, we would put on music videos. I just was always making my sister do whatever crazy idea that I had. I would do makeup tutorials and put on infomercials, literally everything. If you put a camera in front of us, we were just hamming it up.
I hope I get to dance with them. Oh, that would be so exciting.
Come, girls, come.
Hey, that's my necklace. That's my hairpiece.
Ow. She was always entertaining, putting on plays. I felt bad for her sister because she'd always have her doing, you know, oh, I want you to do this, I want you to do this. We want to go put this play on for mom and dad. And it was funny, but she was always very creative. And I knew that someday she was going to be in entertainment somehow.
I remember going, my mom and my grandmother took my sister and I to Radio City to see the Rockettes. And I remember specifically being in the, going to the bathroom, and they have a little dressing room that leads into the bathroom. And I remember sitting there and looking in the mirror with the lights thinking, oh, I'm gonna be here someday. Like, I love performing, and I just love the glitz and the glam, and it's just always been my thing.
Weighing at 242 pounds, unhailing from Spencer, Massachusetts. Here is Paul Van Dale.
I loved working out for my dad. I loved being with my dad all the time. I definitely was the coolest girl in third grade, so I'd bring in WWE magazines and show all the boys, oh, this is my dad here. And I thought it was so cool. That was kind of my claim to fame when I was a kid. I think I was about 5 years old. I was watching my dad in a boxing match, and I was, go, daddy, go, go, daddy, go. And he's in there just fighting, and I didn't think anything of it. To me, that was normal. And to be able to see him and this athletic background and boxing in front of all these people, to me, being a performer and entertainment was almost an attainable goal because that seemed normal to me.
At the time, I had a gym in my basement, and I was watching her during the day, and I would take her downstairs, and I'd say, well, you know, Dad's gonna go lift. I'd always bring her some cookies, so she'd be sitting on one bench, and I'd be working out on the other one. And,
yeah, but she also had her weights, two-pound weights, yeah. She'd be down there.
She'd be down there with a little dumbbell. She'd be in early in her jumpsuit, her workout suit, and she'd be down there working out.
And, doing sit-ups.
Oh, yeah, she was working out her whole life.
It meant everything to be able to see that whatever your dreams are, you can follow them, and you don't have to do everything in a conventional, traditional way, because my family is definitely not traditional and conventional, and I think that it's cool. I wouldn't change it for the world.
I used to have to stand on a box. I'm not good at it.
Oh, go slow, go. They're part of their environment, and they grew up around it, and it's something that became a part of her. I mean, she came to see me wrestle for the first time when she was 10 months old, and she came to see me box for her first time when she was 5 years old. So she grew up around that and between dancing and everything else, and she just got into the good nutrition and a strong work ethic for training, and it shows today. I had her doing hip tosses, snap mirrors.
Probably one of my neck hurts. So when I had my tryout, we did these drills, it's called the set go. So you're like down on your back and then you're back up until like ready to lock up. So I just came here all the time and I'd be like doing these set goes and like be killing myself in here just trying to get like my cardio and my stamina up and just hitting the mitts with him, and yeah, it's really weird. Even when I found out that I got the contract, we still came here and I was training.
Yeah.
Because I found out in July and I didn't start until October.
Right.
So I spent the last few months here just conditioning and getting the bag.
With the boxing workouts, and then going in the ring and working on a few moves,
Yeah.
She's fabulous.
She is.
FAB.
I can't with you guys. You're the best.
So right out of high school, I was ready to move to LA. I knew I wanted to move to LA, I wanted to dance, I wanted to be in entertainment. And my mom said that she would support me doing that, but first I had to go to college. And I really did not want to go to school because I just thought, well, why do I need a college education if I want to be a dancer? I don't need that.
That's my thing. And I said, you do whatever you want, I support you 100%, but you need to have an education. And after you do your 4 years, you do whatever you want. People can come and go and you can do what you need to do, but nobody can ever take your education away.
I'm very grateful that I have a degree in marketing. I do have a bachelor's degree, and I'm grateful that my parents made me go to college because it's something that I'll have for the rest of my life. When I was in college is when I was cheering for the Patriots, so it was a great part-time job to have in school, because I thought, well, if I can't live in LA, I'm at least gonna do something.
Well, the thing is, she never cheerleaded a day in her life. So we're saying, well, you're gonna try, but I'm gonna be behind her when she goes, when she makes the decision to do something. I'm not gonna talk her out of it.
When I graduated college, I found out about that tryout for the Lakers. So I graduated in May. It was the day before, and I thought, I'm just gonna do it. I had one credit card that had like maybe a $500 limit, and I like maxed it out to fly out to LA and try out for the Lakers. And I told my parents, I'm gonna do it. And I'm sure they thought, okay, good luck.
Cause it was just like on a whim. She's like, I think I'm just gonna fly out to LA and try out for the Lakers. I'm like, really?
I think they had like 700 girls try out. I think they only had like 4 or 5 spots open.
Yeah.
So we were hoping for, but the chances weren't looking too
good.
Yeah,
we were like, wow.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your next contestant, Carmella! Hi, you can tell us your name and why we should hire you as a WWE diva.
I never thought when I was doing it that my daughter's gonna grow up to wanna do that. Going from being a cheerleader for the Patriots and the Lakers and then going into, WWE ring, getting the contract was, first step. She got that, and when she was in NXT, she worked out, and she progressed down there.
Watched some of her shows, went down there.
Flew to Florida to see several of her shows down there.
I just felt like early on in NXT, because I didn't come from the independents, I wasn't Sasha Banks or Bayley or Becky or Charlotte. I think that was my biggest hurdle, because I didn't have that background. I did have a dance background, but I just knew I had to bring something different to the table. And I remember calling my mom and dad and being like, I don't know what it is to make me, how do I stand out? How do I make it different? And they're just like, you have to be you. Like, let yourself, your personality, like, through. And that's where I came up with the Carmella character.
Yeah, you're tough. And if my aunt had hair on her back, she'd be my uncle.
Oh, down goes Zoe.
I'm here to fight, okay? I'll be here tomorrow.
All right, Carmella.
You guys are gonna help me whether you like it or not.
She excelled in down there, and then they moved her up. When they moved her up to the main roster, we were like, you know, extremely happy for her.
Now we've got one final draft pick to make here tonight to see who SmackDown's been able to counter with.
Who's it gonna be?
Up next, Carmella.
Hottest chick in the ring.
Yeah, we watched it. Well, we went down there when they did the draft, and we were down at the Centrum when they did it, because it was here in Worcester. And
we didn't think she was going to get drafted, and we hear the last draft, Carmella. Like, it turned out to be a good night.
It does, yeah.
I think from day one, everyone's doubted me. So when I did make it to the main roster, and that was the last draft pick, I know everyone's, oh, Carmella's last draft pick. No, it was kind of an afterthought, and I thought, okay, cool, I'll show you guys an afterthought. I'll be the last draft pick. I'll just be the valet. I'll just be the, you know, the hype girl. And I think just kind of lit a flame in me and led me to where I'm at now.
Wait a minute.
Ladies and gentlemen, Carmella is cashing in her Money in the Bank contract.
Oh my God! Carmella's cashing in! This is brilliant! Carmella with the kick! Charlotte Flair is down!
New champion!
Carmella is champion! Here is your winner and the new SmackDown Women's Champion, Carmella!
Oh, baby girl! Thank you so much.
I was telling everybody around me, that's my daughter, she just won the title. Everybody's shaking my hand. I'm like, yeah, I couldn't help myself. It was just overjoyed with emotion, and it was just, I couldn't believe it.
Just seeing them there when I won was just meant everything, because it's like they've been with me through everything and seen all of my trials and tribulations and just nonsense, silly jobs and just trying to make it. Being where I'm at and seeing them like so proud and just clapping and cheering me on and being like, I did it. Like, I finally did it. I did something that, even though it was seemed so far-fetched and how hard it was, they were always supportive. You can do it, you know you can do it, even when I was feeling down and feeling like this isn't for me and maybe I'm not cut out for the WWE because I'm too small or I don't come from wrestling or I'm not an independent wrestler, but I did it. And they're always so supportive, so I'm so, so lucky.
You know, I did a lot of stuff, but nothing makes me more proud of my two daughters, man. You know? She's a star. You can just see it in it.
It means everything to make my parents proud. I feel like they've encouraged me my entire life to follow my dreams and do whatever it is I want to do. Without them, I wouldn't be where I'm at. So I just always want to make them proud.